not, then, if you have your Bibles, we ask you to turn to the book of James, James chapter 4, and we're going to begin reading in the first verse. As you're turning there, I will say regarding the book of James, a lot of people want to throw it out that it's not inspired or that it's not canonized because it talks so much about works. And the book of James does talk a whole lot about works, but they are in their proper order. He said, I will show you my faith by my works. And the reason people don't like it, we do come to the conclusion that faith without works is dead, meaning it's not living, it's not a real faith. And that's why it's not necessarily everyone's favorite book. James chapter 4, in the first verse, the Bible says, from whence come wars and fighting among you? Come they not from hence, even from your lust and that war in your members? You lust and have not, you kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you have not because you ask not. You ask and receive not because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your lust. You adulterers and adulteresses, know you not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is an enemy of God. Do you think the scripture saith in vain, the spirit dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? But he giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and watch care. Lord, we thank you for your blessings. Lord, we thank you for a place to meet tonight out of the cold, Lord, and we praise you for that. Lord, we think of others that probably don't have that opportunity tonight, and we'd like to give you praise that we do have something, and we do have a place, and you do meet with us from time to time. We pray tonight that you would honor your word, Lord, that you would stir up the hearts of the listeners with it. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, I'll be preaching tonight on the thought, removing the things in the way. Now, we live in a day and age, and I hear this from everybody, everywhere I go, is that you don't seem to feel, you don't seem to have, it doesn't look like the Lord moved like he once did. And I will have to say, invariably, that is true. Now, the reason cannot be God, it has to be us, because the Bible says, I am the Lord, I change not. And so if there has been a change somewhere, the change is with us. And we look at different things in the apostolic area and amazing things that God did. And again, the Bible's clear, I change not. And so the problem today that we can't get closer to the Lord, it has to be us. And I really believe that's what James is addressing. He begins, from whence come their wars and fightings among you? Now, and I can see it to some extent, although he never really gets back to that idea in his text. Some people will say, well, that the church had problems. The church had divisions. I don't believe that. I believe the problem was individuals. And so, whence comes their fighting in you? Well, I tell you, if you have a saved inward man and a lost outward man, and those two will always fight, just like Jacob and Esau, there was always a division there. Just like Cain and Abel, there was always a problem between those two, and there will always be a problem between our outward flesh and the inward man. And if we can't learn to put the outward flesh aside, it will get the victory. Now, does that mean you're lost? No, it doesn't. But it means that the devil does have a heyday with you. You ever met somebody in all seriousness, and if you've been honest with me, you will be truthful from the very first moment you didn't like them. You just met them and say, that's not somebody I would like. Now, let me say that first motive in itself is ungodly. But we always have those individuals that kind of push our buttons, so to speak, and that is not of the inward man, and you will have a great deal of difficulty witnessing to these people. Then notice he says in verse 2, you lust, or you want, you're driven, you lust and have not. Now, what again, I believe that's the inward man. He's saying you will never satisfy this flesh. If you get a Corvette, you'll want two Corvettes. If you get a 6-bedroom house, you'll want an 8-bedroom house. This flesh is not satisfiable ever. Now you think the challenge that the Lord Jesus gave the rich young ruler, he says, go sell all you have and come and follow me. Listen, there's not one of you under the sound of my voice tonight that could really, really do that, and I'm including myself in that. Sell it all and follow me. But really, has the call of the Lord really changed? I don't think it has. We don't need to be so needed into this world. And that was the problem to the church that James was writing to. They were so involved in the world, they weren't growing spiritually. And I'm fearful today that that's where we've arrived at in many of our churches, is that we're just not growing because we're too much in depth with this world. Verse 4, ye adulterers and adulteresses. Now, again, verse 4, I don't think he's talking about the carnality of adultery. I don't believe the men were running around on their women and the women running around on their men. I believe the believers were running around on their God. I believe the believers were committing a spiritual adultery, giving more time, more energy, more effort into this world than in the world to come. And listen, you can be caught up in it so, so very quickly. And before you know it, you've wasted all the day into idleness and really gained nothing in a spiritual sense. And so we see then that as James is writing, that he begins to be very specific in what his recommendation is. Verse 5, do you think the Scripture saith in vain, the Spirit... Notice it's the little S spirit. The Spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy. Now, that means that broken nature, it doesn't mean the soul, that natural push of man, all it's worried about, all it likes is lusting. If you have a blue house, if your neighbor has a blue house, you want yours to be dark blue. If your Corvette is white and his is red, you want yours to be even more red. We are never a satisfied people, nor will we ever be. But you know, we've got to learn. If you want spiritual victory, and everybody equates spiritual victory to redemption, you know what? That is not the same. I know a lot of saved folks that live in defeat on an everyday basis. They wake up defeated, they go to bed defeated, they spend their entirety of the day with that Eeyore, oh woe is me attitude, and they live in defeat all the time. You know what? That ought not to be among God's people. But it will be, as long as you let this stuff right here rule the roost. It will be, because it's insatiable. You can't satisfy what this flesh is about. Then he says, in verse number 6, but he, meaning the Lord, but he giveth more grace. So even though we have an outline of 5 different problems in verses 1-5, in the 6th we have our resolution and we have the defeat of the problem. God giveth more grace. In other words, you don't have an excuse. You can't say, well, that's just the way my flesh is. And say, that's just, you know, we'll just have to accept it as that. No, no. If you're sincerely seeking a presence with God, and that's what really it comes down to, is seeking time alone with God. If you're really minded that way, the Bible says, he giveth more grace. But he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud. God resisteth the proud. Now, be very careful about raising your feathers. Because if you raise your feathers, everybody's seen a big old male peacock? Beautiful, bounty, flat feathers on the back. You know one thing about a peacock? It's very easy to grab those feathers and pull them out. Anybody ever done that? I've done it. I mean, they come right out. Now, you might get clawed in the meantime, but not much of it really holding there. And so, be very, very cautious about what you pride yourself in. Because it'll be very quickly taken away. I personally think that Job had a real issue with pride, and God made him abased. He put him down. And so we find then that God gives us more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. So the first thing that you're going to need, if you want to be near unto God, is really make a very objective evaluation of how proud or humble you truly are. You know, I found this to be true in every opposer to sovereign grace. When you boil off their water, their argument is this: they want to do something for themselves. That's not fair. It can't be that way. No, they want something like baptism or saying a little magical prayer or something that they can do themselves. And that is, you know what that is? That's the worst sort of pride there is. That's why sovereign grace hurts. It puts us right down here. We need to see us, and I mean the redeemed, as a very needy, needy people. We have not arrived. We don't know it all. And so, if we're really going to get to this point, you know what helps me? You know what makes me think of the humbleness? That if it wasn't for the goodness of God, I could be born in a country where the name of Jesus has never even been proclaimed. And the only difference is God put me here instead of there. That'll bring you down where you need to be. We don't need to be walking around with our feathers up in the air and saying, "Hey, I'm a good sovereign grace Baptist." You need to be humble. You need to be humble. Verse 7. Submit yourselves therefore to God. Now, the first element is your humbleness. The second element is how submitted are you to God. Now, that's a difficult thing to measure, but I'll give you something to chew on this week. The Bible says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Yeah. So, how submitted to that book are you? That's really a measure of how submitted to God you are, is it not? If the Word is God, and the Word is, and you can measure your submission, that's why I don't really get an understanding when people say, "Well, I just don't believe the Bible teaches that." Well, it's in black and white. What do you think the Bible does teach? If the Bible says to be a keeper at home, it doesn't take rocket science to figure that out. That's like third grade English, is it not? Easy, easy stuff. So measure your submission to God by the submission to His Word. Measure your humbleness to Him by your humbleness to this Word. The second part of this, a lot of people don't like it, and some would even consider it Pentecostal. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Let me say this: God's sovereign, Satan is not. God's on his throne and does what seemeth good unto himself, according to the Word of God. The devil doesn't. Have you ever thought and wondered if Eve had said, "Get thee hence, Satan, you're a fence unto me"? Been a very different story, wouldn't it? We can resist him. Do we have power? Can we command him to go somewhere? No. But Lord, God, clear my mind. Get my mind off that. Lord, strengthen me. Open your word to me. Pray, resist the devil. It is a real thing to do. And I really believe while we don't live in victory more, is that the day, what did the Lord inspire? I think it was the church, not at Laodicea, not at Philadelphia, maybe Ephesus, but I don't think that's right either. But he says, I know where Satan's seat is. I know which pew belongs to him. I know where he sits every Sunday. And a lot of people have postulated, well, did they have an enemy of God in the church as a member? Maybe, I doubt it. I mean, what, tonight, if our eyes, spiritual eyes, would be open as Gehazi was in the days of Elijah, and opened up and be able to see that the demons and the angels, even in this room tonight, if we could see through spiritual eyes, we would be blown away. We would be blown away. And so we see that we as the Lord's people then, we need to be in a condition where the Word is something we could submit to always. Then the third thing there, draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to you. So that says to me, there's always room for improvement. Right? We've not arrived yet. We still have this stinking flesh to contend with on a routine basis, right? And so, with that fact and knowing that to be true, how close are you to God? What can you do daily to be closer to Him? What can you do to draw nigh, get nearer and nearer and nearer? I believe that we can live in victory, don't you? That's what the Scriptures teach, right? But I believe the reason that we don't, we're so intermingled with this world, and we're so far from God, that we don't. We don't hear from Him like we should. And so we find then that we as the Lord's people need to get the things that are in the way out of the way. Things like hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is you thinking you know it all and you know better than the next and you're more nice than the next and you do this better than other people do it. That is hypocrisy. Because you know what? The ground is very level at the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're all the same, hopelessly lost and horribly, horribly standing in need of a move from God. It's all leveled up right there. And we need to remember that. That's what will keep you from being a hypocrite. That's what will keep you from saying, you know what, this really makes me mad. It will keep you in a condition where you're focused on Christ instead of focusing on yourself. Watch your anger. Watch what you do in anger. And be very cautious of malice. That is keeping things in your mind and your heart against another. They will wreck your closeness to God. Gospel of Mark. We found some individuals that were very committed to being close unto God. Mark chapter 2, in the very first verse. Mark chapter 2. In the very first verse, and again he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noised that he was there in the house. Now what had happened? He had gone into Capernaum, he had done some miracles, he had left, and he kind of slipped back in the city, and people began to talk and say, he's back, he's down at so-and-so's house, and there began to be a group of people, and straightway, many were gathered together, and so much there was no room to receive them. In other words, the house was full, and now it was spilling out. No, not so much as about the door, and he preached the word unto them. You know, and I won't get much on this tonight, but what a wonderful thing it is just to hear the preaching of the Word of God. Just knowing that you can go somewhere and sit under preaching and hear from God. Because you know what? All these other things are fine. But the Bible says, through the foolishness of preaching, I will... Does it save them? I can't even remember the exact wording, but in other words, your social ministries don't work. It's okay to feed hungry people, but don't entangle that with spreading the gospel, because you're not. It's okay to clothe people that needs clothes, but that is not the gospel. Does that make sense? And so we see then that the Lord Jesus wasn't giving away favors. He was simply preaching what they needed to hear. Verse 3, and they came unto him, bringing one sick of the palsy that was born of four. Now that word palsy has never really changed that much at all. Our adopted daughter Anna has a palsy. All of you remember Anna? She can't do anything for herself except maybe feed herself some. She can't walk. She can't move from a bed to a chair unassisted. She can't do any of that. You know, that's you. That is you and I in light of the glorious gospel of Christ. You can't move toward Christ. Now, we'd like to think that we could, but we can't. This young man could do nothing. Now the Bible says he was born of four. You know what that is? That's a man, four men that bent business with God. Why would you ask somebody to come here at New Testament Church if you didn't feel like they could get some help when they got here? See, I don't know who these men were. Well, you know, I don't know their background, but I do know this. They knew something of the nature of our Lord, because they were willing to carry a man to the feet of Jesus to get him some help. That shows me they knew something about what Jesus was able to do. They had heard something about the results that came from simply being around the Lord Jesus. They knew something. So they were willing to carry this man that could do nothing for himself. Now, that makes me wonder how missionary I really am. And am I willing to pack somebody if need be? Verse 4, when they could not come nigh unto him, meaning Christ, for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. Now let me say this. Most of us would not have even done the carrying. And when we got there and we saw the crowd and couldn't get into it, we would say, well, this is it. This is as far as we can go. There's nothing left to be done. We took it as far as we can. But these four men, whomever they were, had a greater desire and a greater determination and picked him up on top of the house. Now, many of you have never done this, but years ago when I worked for the ambulance service, the other day I saw him pick up somebody at the nursing home where I was, and they was like, and pressing all these little things. And I'm like, well, I wish I had that 30 years ago. I wouldn't have shoulder trouble now, because back then we did this and we came up with it. Now, I came up with some pretty good-sized people. But you know what? I never put anybody on top of the house. And I would dare say, me and Leon, that's the guy I always worked with, Mr. Leon Collis, I don't think we could have got anybody up on top of the house. Now, we were pretty good. We could predict each other's moves. But we only had to come up about 4 feet to get them in that ambulance. That's all we needed. You know, to get them on top of the house, they had to work. If you've ever picked up another adult person, it's not easy. You have to be determined. So these men somehow were convinced of the ability of Christ, because they went to an extraordinary effort to get him near unto the feet of Jesus. Now, you know the rest of the story. He looked up and said, and was pleased by the faith that they had illustrated. And he said to the young man, thy sins be forgiven thee. And he got up and walked. Now, You also know the story how he was criticized for what he said. But why did he have the palsy to start with? It was to glorify God. But the result of any kind of health defect is this body giving way. And you know why it gives way? Because of sin. And if the Lord should not return in my lifetime and I'm pushing up the daisies next door, you know why I'll be pushing up daisies? Because his body's finally give out. And so what he really said when he says, "Thy sins be forgiven thee," that's what it took to relieve the condition. Does that make sense? The real problem, the root problem of his debility was sin. And the root problem of us coming nigh unto Christ and tearing off the roof tiles and letting ourselves down, whatever's necessary to getting close to them, close to him, the problem is sin. That's why we don't get closer than we do. We don't want to be a fanatic. We don't want people to think we're crazy. No, no. We need to set all self and sin aside and get close to the Lord Jesus Christ. Go with me to the book of Psalms. Psalm 64. Psalm 69, verse 14. Psalm 69 and verse 14, the Bible says, "Deliver me out of the mire, and let me not sink. Let me be delivered for them that hate me, and out of the deep waters." Now, I want you to see, as David is making this prayer to God, he does not minimize the situation that he's in. Now, we live in a day and age today where we minimize our problems. If you ask me how I am, most of the time, I'll say, "I'm fine, I'm good," right? How many times is that really the case? Now, most of the time, I am good. I don't have a lot of problems. But sometimes we're lying, or at the very best, we're not looking at it in a spiritual sense. And you know why? Because we're prideful people. We don't want to say, "Listen, I'm cold. I hadn't heard from God in 2 weeks. I'm in a mess." We don't want to say that, right? And the reason why, when you get it down, you get down to it really, it's because of pridefulness, that we don't want anybody to think that we could actually be sinful enough to not hear from God, but we are. And so we see David doesn't have any of those misgivings. He lays it out. "Let not the water flood overflow me, neither let the deep swallow me up, and let not the pit shut her mouth upon me." Now let me say this. With all this calamity he's describing, it wasn't in a battle and it wasn't in a war. It was all going on spiritually. There was not one event where somebody was setting a bead on him literally at that point. But he knew it was out there. "Hear me, O God, for thy loving kindness is good. Turn unto me according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, and hide not thy face from thy servant, for I am in trouble. Hear me speedily." I'm in trouble. Now, here's a man, the Bible says, was after God's own heart. And we find he says, "I'm in trouble. I'm in need. I need some help." Why do we have to be so prideful that we cannot say, "Listen, I need some help. I'm in a bad shape. I would love for you to pray for me. I'd love for you to seek after God's face. Do something for me." Listen, when I, from that very pulpit right there, say, "Pray for me as your pastor," I'm not just blowing smoke. Do you think it's easy to pastor one of the Lord's true churches? Do you think it's an easy thing to look through that book and sift through the Spirit and say, "Hey, what do I need to feed my little flock here tonight?" It's not easy.
No.
We need to pray one for another.
Amen.
And pray that the Lord would definitely meet with us. And so we see that David was much too humble again. He was much too humble to put any kind of paint on it. He just said it like it was. Then he says in verse 18, draw nigh unto my soul and redeem it. Deliver me because of mine enemies. There are two things. He knew God had to come to him. Draw nigh unto my soul and redeem it. Now, redeemed often has to do with redemption, the buyback of our souls. But I don't think that David was a saved man at this point. But sometimes we just, you know what's wrong with our churches today? You just don't hear anybody talking about sin. You don't find anybody talking about coldness. You don't find anybody saying, hey, I could be the problem. You don't find any of that, do you? I travel a whole lot, or I used to. And it's not just New Testament church at Dover. It's all over. It's all over. People don't want to address sin. And always, 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 the problem with that is this. It's pride. You boil the water off, and it's always, I don't want them knowing that that occurred in my life. That's what it gets down to. And so we see then that David has none of these things. He just says, draw nigh to my soul and redeem it. Deliver me because of mine enemies. And certainly that's what we need. One more place. Very familiar verses of Scripture. Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3. Moses is meeting the person of the Lord God. And we find, let's read in the first verse. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight while the bush is not burned. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he says, here I am. And he said, draw not nigh hither, but put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Now, I want you to notice a number of things, and this is where we should be standing. Standing on holy ground. That's where we need to be positioned. Now, with that said, I want you to see the first thing. He was doing something that was very ordinary. The Lord don't come tonight and I get up and my day progresses as usual. I will be teaching tomorrow. Very routine thing for me to do. That says to me that God can intervene at any time He wants to. And when He does, we need to be ready. The next common everyday thing was the fire. Now, it was not uncommon to have brush fires in that place and in that time. The backside of the what? The desert. It doesn't take rocket scientists to figure that out. A brush fire can't even be common here in Tennessee in the dry seasons in August. So he was not only just looking at the fire, he noticed something different about the fire. See, the fire that it was raging wasn't the point. The fire was that it wasn't even consuming what it was set on. It was sitting there, it was not being consumed. And he says, this is extraordinary, I'm going to go to it. So that says to me, if you don't look at specific instances in your life, you're going to miss it. You're going to miss the presence of God because He's not going to come and bowl you over out of a routine. I bet he had seen 100 brush fires. And he looked at this one and said, you know what? That's not being consumed. It's burning and burning and burning and it's still there just like it was 10 minutes ago. And he said, I'm going to go check this out. And when he saw that ordinary, he got a little bit closer. God said, listen, kick your shoes off. You're on holy ground. So whatever your plan is for tomorrow, if you're like me, you have to hit the ground running and go back to work. That's fine. But look, when you get there, you can be on holy ground. The important thing and the way that we as the Lord's people need to be is humble ourselves and look for those entrances that you can stand in holy ground. Because they're out there. You can lend yourself to usefulness, or you can die a miserable old Christian. That's really the only two choices you have. But wouldn't it be a wonderful thing just to live on holy ground? Mm-hmm. Every opportunity, move that much closer to it.
Yeah.
That's what we need to do.